Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to the sixth meeting of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in 2024. I've received apologies from the convener, Martin Whitfield, MSP. And our first item today is for new members to declare any relevant interests. So welcome Jackie Dunbar, MSP, as a new committee member. Jackie, do you have any relevant interests to declare?
Thank you, convener. I think at this point the only register of interest I would have would be that I was a former councillor for Aberdeen City Council up until May 22, because I believe that we're going to be discussing elections further on. So,
great. Thank you very much. That's been noted. And our next item is for the committee to agree whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Agenda item 4 is consideration of the evidence heard in the evidence session of the Commission for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland. And agenda item 5 is consideration of the correspondence the committee has received. Are members content to take these items in private?
Yes.
Thank you. So our next item for today is for the committee to hear evidence from the Commissioner for Ethical Standards and Public Life in Scotland. I'd like to welcome Ian Bruce to the meeting, and I'd like to invite the Commissioner to make some opening remarks. Okay.
Thank you, Convener and members of the committee, for the invitation and the opportunity to talk to you about the work of our office. I'm keen to ensure that the committee is fully informed about my office's and my own performance. So I'll keep my opening statement very brief to allow as much time as possible for questions. I'll ask you to give evidence to the committee at an informal briefing in September of last year due to a change in membership. I hope you're all enjoying your new role. I trust since then that you've reviewed our last annual report and our annual report and accounts, and that these will have given you an indication of the significant progress that we have made in implementing the recommendations made to us by the Auditor-General for Scotland. As the annual report testifies, and as discussed with the committee in September, the intervening period has been extremely busy for us, but we are content and indeed have assurance from our auditors that we are operating effectively as an organisation. There's been no follow-up Section 22 report, and in fact, Audit Scotland had no recommendations whatsoever for us, as will be apparent from the annual report and accounts, which we laid with the Parliament in December. In effect, our office now has a clean bill of health. I'm pleased to be able to report to the committee that we've now implemented all of the auditor's recommendations that we were able to, and we've also implemented almost all of the additional recommendations that our internal auditors had for us. We've successfully recruited and inducted the new staff that I spoke to the committee about in September, and they've completed their probationary periods, and they're already adding value across the work of our office. And in particular, that's in reducing the number of complaints requiring initial assessment. Waiting times have now reduced to 4 months, which wasn't easy to achieve in the face of what have been rising complaint and investigation numbers during the course of the year. On the progress made, we've included all of the detail on our website and in summary in our annual report, and I'm happy to provide more detail during the course of the session. In terms of my plans for the future, I published a new draft strategic plan for 2024 to 28 in November. It was subject to extensive consultation, including with this committee, and it sets out an ambitious pathway for our office for the next four-year period. I'll be publishing the final version, which incorporates the feedback that we've received prior to the end of this month. I'm now very happy to take any questions that the committee may have for me.
Great, thank you very much for that that update. I'd like to go to Stephen Kerr for the first questions. Thank you.
Well, yes, good morning, Ian. Welcome back to the committee. So, first of all, well done on being able to comply with the Auditor-General's list of recommendations. I think there were there 10? I can't remember.
Or 22.
No, 22?
Yes.
Right,
yes,
okay.
Yes.
So, 22 to get all together. Can I ask you, first of all, about resource?
Yes.
Because that had been one of the aspects of the challenges you had to deal with when you came to office.
Indeed.
How's that going now? Where are you in terms of the complement?
Fully staffed.
Fully staffed?
Fully staffed, yes. There are now 20 members of staff overall, myself included. The final piece of the jigsaw puzzle joined us just recently, and that was a part-time governance and finance officer to provide support to the corporate services team. The entire investigations team completed their probationary periods round about sort of October, November, because their start dates were staggered last year. So I'm very happy that we have the resources that we require.
That's very good. One of the job descriptions that I'd like to just ask you to speak about, just to give us some background on, is the public appointments advisors, because that's not staff position, that's a contractor position. How does that work and how is that going?
It's going very well. So we, on a sort of semi-regular basis, go out to tender for these individuals. They're consultants.
Yeah.
They work to us under what's known as a service level agreement. Full-time equivalent, if you are concerned about, you know, the sort of resourcing implications for us, sits at around 1.8 members of staff. They're recruited on the basis of their expertise in recruitment and selection, with a particular focus on equality and diversity. They aren't the policemen in the corner, they're my representatives, but their role is to basically assist panels in order to achieve the best possible outcome on appointment rounds.
So how frequently is there a refreshing of the contractors? How does that work?
Yes, so we need sufficient capacity across the entire team to ensure that, because we have any number of appointment rounds running at a given time, and I determine how much oversight of those should be provided based on a number of factors, you know, the budget of the body, how its governance is at any given time. But we need sufficient spread to ensure that we can allocate to any number of appointment rounds simultaneously. Mm-hmm. Optimum number for us of advisors is around 12, which is where we're sitting at the moment. Mm-hmm. When it dips to 10 or so, we usually go out to tender again in order to ensure that we have sufficient complement. Yeah.
On the structure chart, it says you're looking for 14. That would be the top end then.
It would, indeed.
Because there's about 100 and odd appointments every year, isn't
there? So, correct.
So what about the profile of these people?
Yes.
Now, there's a reason why I'm asking this.
Yes.
You'll understand in relation to the recruitment to public bodies, which, you know, is an important part of what you do. What's the profile of the sorts of people that are acting as public appointment advisors?
Well, it varies, but primarily, and again, I'd be very happy to share the details with the committee, you know, our tendering process and the attributes that we look for. But in general terms, they have a background in recruitment and selection with a particular focus on equality and diversity.
Are they themselves quite a diverse group in terms of their backgrounds? Can you just give us a sample of the sorts of different backgrounds they have?
Yes. Let me see. We have one individual who herself is an advisor to the CIPD on recruitment and selection. So, you know, that would give you an indication of the calibre of individual who's involved. We have another individual, I suppose two, who used to work as independent advisors for OCPA. So, you know, that was the equivalent commissioner for England and Wales. Mm-hmm. One of them was herself the chair of an NHS trust in England, so, you know, has that particular background.
The reason I just get to the point of why I'm asking this is because, you know, while I understand that protected characteristics, diversity is important, and I can see there's a lot of effort goes into that.
Yes.
One of the aspects of the profile of those who serve on public boards is they are all pretty much alike. I mean, so, for example, predominantly these are people that are high-income people. The number of people that are serving on boards, or chairs or on boards, that are earning low to middle incomes is pretty small compared with those that are earning over, say, $75,000 a year. The background of the people that are being appointed to public bodies, including chairs, predominantly public sector. Relatively few people from the private sector compared with the public, maybe about half as many, and even fewer when it comes to the voluntary sector. I'm asking these questions that you can gather. What is happening that there seems to be a replication of the same sorts of people joining these public body boards?
Yes.
That seems to me, on looking at it from an optics point of view, that seems to be somewhat less than optimal.
No, I agree, absolutely. And, you know, that's why we ensure that the government gives us these figures and we report publicly on them. So, you know, there is definitely more that can be done in terms of diversity. So you'd asked about the cohort of PAAs. They have a very broad range of backgrounds, and in terms of visible diversity, it is an exceptionally diverse group.
Apparent,
yes.
Characteristics.
Yes, yeah, indeed.
But
in
are
terms
they
of protected characters.
Predominantly public sector people with high incomes?
No. There is a range in there. So some have that background, others certainly don't. I don't think it would be legitimate of me to get into the detail with you because...
I understand the delicate aspect of that.
But you know, you do make a very relevant point, and it's why I think we do need to refresh Diversity Delivers. So there are things that can be done on an appointment round by appointment round basis in order to increase diversity, and that's what our PAAs are there to encourage.
As long as that diversity is not just... So there are specific targets that have been set for diversity by what I'm calling protected characteristics.
Yeah.
But I didn't read, unless I've missed it, and that's possible, I didn't read of any particular drive to see that the people that are appointed are coming from a diverse background income in household income terms and also in terms of their work experience.
No, I agree, and that's something we should see. So I've spoken to the committee previously about the fact that the strategy that we should have, which should be, I think, national and regional as opposed to on an appointment round by appointment round basis, the focus of that should change. It was last designed in 2008 and published.
Right.
So all of the targets that were in it at that point in time did relate to protected characteristics, and it came back to what it said in the 2003 Act and what it says in the Scotland Act. That was the focus at the time.
Right.
I think you're right, our focus should move now, and we should be looking to bring on board people from a much wider range of backgrounds. So I absolutely agree with that point.
You've brought the discipline, the necessary discipline for any organisation, public or private, of planning.
Yes.
Is there anything in the plans that we've not seen that is going to move the dial in the direction that we're discussing?
That's what's set out in my strategic plan for the next 4 years, which is a refresh of that strategy.
A refresh?
Yes.
Right.
And yes, there will need to be more focus on broader diversity. I think it's worth saying, so it does happen on an appointment round by appointment round basis, and I'm going to use one example because it might help bring it to life.
Sure.
The Poverty and Inequality Commission. So, I think this is a very relevant example. When they went out to look for their members and convener initially, the criteria for selection were such that it was a very different demographic that came on board there. And when I changed the code as well, but perhaps it might be helpful to point this out, I'd made it clear to ministers, look, it's not just... skills, knowledge and experience that you're looking for, because you know that does tend to mean that you're fishing in the same pool.
Yeah.
Think more broadly about it. There are other attributes. You can be looking for things like lived experience.
Yeah.
So in terms of the Poverty and Inequality Commission, we were looking for people with lived experience. I say we, it was the ministers.
Yeah.
And the process was designed to deliver that. So you ended up with a cohort of new board members who look very different.
Yeah.
And it does happen on an appointment round by appointment round basis. So NHS boards might be looking for people with lived experience of inequalities when trying to access health services.
Yeah.
But I do think we need to look at it on a sort of more national and regional basis. And that's why the plan to refresh that strategy is in my strategic plan.
Do you expect, as a result of the refresh, and... It's obviously in focus because it's in your report.
Yes.
You know, so first of all, that's good. The reason I can ask these questions is because you've provided us with the information in your report.
Yes.
So do you expect over the next period the dial will move? The next year? The next 2 years?
It will take time. I mean, these things always take
100
time.
100 appointments on average a year.
Yes. Yeah.
So we might see some.
And well, I'll continue to report to this committee, and you know we'll be able to track progress in that way. But I would expect. So we're starting our research in I think July, and that's basically just to do the same job that we did in advance of 2008. You know, like what are the issues and how do we address them?
Yeah.
And that will require not just desk-based research, but focus groups and that type of thing. There needs to be a considerable amount of awareness raising as well with the public, because I'm not sure that people necessarily see themselves in these roles.
Yeah.
And you're not going to address that on an appointment round by appointment round
That's
basis.
Right.
Territorial health boards, you know, they do some outreach themselves, so, you know, that's helpful, but I think we need to look
yeah.
much more widely. So there is going to have to be some sort of national campaign,
yeah.
I think. But let us do our research.
I agree. I think
yes.
a few more people, particularly with private sector or voluntary sector backgrounds,
yes.
need to be a little nudged
yes.
to make themselves real, because they may not see themselves, you're absolutely right,
yes.
they may not see themselves in the context of that sort of a role, and
yes.
yet their experience is a critical,
yes.
if they're not there, then it's a critical missing piece.
Absolutely. When I refreshed the code, I said as much in the introduction. I mean, you know, these boards should be reflective of the communities that they serve.
Yeah.
And that's a very broad church.
Yes, it is. Do you want me to carry on? Or?
Please carry on.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, just move
so,
on.
So I'll wait for the convener to tell me to...
No, you just cover what needs to be covered.
It's a fascinating
committee members will come in as appropriate.
I'd like to talk a bit more about the strategy
sure.
that's included in the report. You talk about one of your, in fact, it's your top objective at the beginning of the report. It talks about creating an effective, it's quite difficult because it's black on green. So, you know, it might be age, but we will operate an effective complaints system.
Yes.
It does go on to talk a little about what that means. Would you just expand on what you see as an effective complaints system? How would you define that?
Yes. So, in general terms, my office is committed to continuous improvement. So we already have what I would describe as an effective complaint handling system in place. We still have a queue, but it's reduced significantly. We need to get that basically down to the lowest possible level. We've got a comprehensive investigations manual in place. It's been published, but it's not set in stone. So every time we get feedback from anyone who comes into contact with our office, it may be witnesses, complainers, respondents, we take that on board and we discuss it as a team, and we'll revise our procedures as necessary in order to improve effectively what is the service that we provide.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not saying that what we do at the moment is ineffective. What I'm saying is there's always room for improvement, and we do improve our practices on an ongoing and regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
We refresh that manual quarterly. So the next refresh is due in April. It was published after I last gave formal evidence to the committee last year. It's been updated since that time. And the measures that we've introduced since that time reflect what we heard from the people who came into contact with us.
So effective then.
Yes.
One of the key elements of effectiveness for anyone that's involved in the system, the process, is going to be speed of decision making. How critical is that?
So speed of decision making is important, but also quality of decision making.
Yeah.
So it has to be both. It's pointless getting through complaints very, very quickly if the decisions aren't right, if they aren't well supported, if people don't understand why those decisions were made. So, you know, those things are very important too. Investigations need to be thorough. You know, it's important that we gather all the evidence that we need in order to reach sound conclusions.
Yeah.
And we need to be able to demonstrate to those who are either complained about or those who've made a complaint that we haven't gathered everything relevant and that the conclusion that we've reached is a sound one.
If a complaint... Now, to be absolutely clear, and I'm aware of this convener, that this committee's jurisdiction doesn't encroach in the area of councillors. But with your permission, I'd like to illustrate the issue of speed of decision by reference to what's in the report about councillors. So the average stage one complaint currently is about, I can't tell, I mean it's in the 50s, it looks like it's about 160 days before someone's either in or is either going to stage two or is having the complaint against them dismissed
yes.
effectively. But then it's a further maybe 170 days in stage two. So it's quite possible that a complaint against an individual, and I'm only using this for illustrative purposes,
sure.
not because, and I do appreciate that there's another committee that will talk to you about councillors,
sure.
but that's the best part of a year.
I know it's not good enough. So that was another backlog situation. I gave a commitment, a firm commitment to this committee the last time I gave formal evidence that we would show waiting times on our website. We've had a banner up since that time.
Yeah.
So January of last year, it was 12 months. Let me think, by the time March had come around, when I gave formal evidence, it was 9. It's now 4. So that is an improving picture.
Yes.
And the firm commitment I gave was to provide also average waiting times for people. So if you've, and this is all on the website,
yeah.
anyone who visits that website will see the banner. It says now, and it was just refreshed last month. Waiting time at the moment for complex complaints, and I think I need to explain something about triage as well, because this may be helpful, but yep. for complex complaints where it looks like, yes, there may well have been a breach of the code, and we're going to have to, you know, and gather evidence, interview witnesses, etc. For those 4 months of admissibility, I committed to showing the average waiting times on the website, so there's a link from the banner, and people can go and see, and it's for different complaint types. So waiting times for MSP complaints is considerably shorter, simply because of, you know, the way in which admissibility for those works.
Mm.
You can see how long it takes for us to investigate complaints about councillors and members there as well. Mm. And again, it's much lower than in the annual report, which obviously is historic.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so obviously we've got the numbers from this report, and you're right, this is a dated report. The one that we're working from now. You've been hard at work at this. You're making
Indeed.
Progress. I've illustrated one example, which is relating
yes.
to councillors. And you may refer to this one or the MSP one
sure.
or the public bodies one. How much of an improvement, I guess, is in your KPIs for the report that we'll be looking at a year from now?
Well, considerable. You know, I mean, since that last annual report, as I've said, you know, and as you've pointed out, it was taking far too long to investigate complaints. But you'll understand from the staffing that I've brought on board that, you know, obviously, we've brought that waiting time down. We're reporting on that quarterly. We're now sitting at, you know, 4 months. And we've also set out the average time for stage two, which I think currently sits at, for councillor member, 127 days. There are always outliers. We've also undertaken to publish progress against our KPIs.
Yeah.
So the manual itself includes how long it should take for each stage of an investigation, all the way up to 100% of complaints. We'll be publishing all that in our annual report so you can see how we are doing against the targets that we've set for ourselves.
And let me say as feedback that I appreciate your willingness to, you know, in terms of accountability. The fact that you're willing to publish KPIs and progress to KPIs. I think that's exactly how public bodies ought to work. So you're modelling the kind of behaviour that we would hope to see from other public bodies as well. So can I thank you sincerely for that? I'm looking...
If we can stop there. Thank you. Excellent questions.
I have
more questions, but
we shall come back to you.
If there's time.
Absolutely.
Okay. May I briefly just mention to
please.
You, convener, if that's possible, because I don't want people around this table to feel that someone whose complaint is going to be dismissed quickly has to wait a long time to hear about it. They don't, because we have a triage system in place, and if we know something isn't admissible, say a service complaint, you know, my councillor doesn't deal, or my MSP isn't dealing with my concerns in the way I would like them to, those are dismissed pretty quickly. You know, they're identified. Those are dismissed, and we have a database that will signpost people to other agencies that can help them. So it's really only the ones where we are actually investigating that have to wait to hear about my decision.
Great. Thank you. Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, and I'd like to follow on. You were saying that just now about it's only the cases that you have got to investigate that are taking a long time, but you've still got to investigate the cases that you don't think are going to take a long time. to realise that they're not going to take a long time. So do you have a time scale for that? I know you said pretty quick, but that could kind of mean anything, if I'm being honest.
Sure. So for the ones that are, might help just to discuss how we work as an office. So the entire investigatory team meets every week. Okay. Senior management team meets monthly. We look at all of those statistics weekly and then monthly. And we have a system whereby complaints at the triage stage are allocated a different colour. So red, amber and green. And those are then allocated to the team of investigating officers. The ones that are green are basically the ones that are readily admissible. So those are taken off the list and dealt with. And I do mean very quickly. It would depend. I mean, we're talking about, you know, a matter of weeks, but it would depend on whether or not some additional information needs to be gathered in order to dismiss. And that could be things like minutes of a council meeting, or it could be a webcast of a council meeting. You know, sometimes people make an accusation that something inappropriate mm-hmm. has been said, but actually when you go and have a look at the meeting, no, you know, what you've suggested has occurred has not in fact occurred. The amber ones take longer, the red ones take longer than that, but the team of IOs has got a case mix. In terms of prioritising them, we do that in date order because, you know, so the most aged ones get looked at first, unless they're readily dismissible. But I spoke about making changes to our processes. One of the changes that we made was at the triage stage, if it looks as though someone's in harm's way. So, you know, we may get a complaint and it might relate to bullying and harassment. Now that sort of conduct can have clearly a really serious impact on someone's health and well-being. Those get pulled out of the queue and prioritised. They go to the top of the queue. Whereas something like, you know, failure to register or declare an interest, you know, fine. It will just be dealt with in date order along with the others. But we don't want people to be in harm's way because of inaction on the part of our office or delayed action on the part of our office.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree with that, and I think there's a duty of care to both sides. Because until you've reached the end of your investigation, you don't know what the outcome is going to be. Can I ask what correspondence is undertaken with both sides of the complaint during the process? Because sometimes there's nothing worse than being left and not being responded to. Sometimes that can be worse for both sides.
Yes, absolutely. So both complainers and respondents are regularly updated, but what I'd mentioned, you know, in terms of how cases are allocated, so each investigating officer, each investigating officer has their own set of cases. Okay. They provide, so it's basically an individual, and they, you know, they carry the case from beginning to end. So their contact details are provided to complainers and respondents, and both complainers and respondents are advised, look, we'll keep you up to date on a regular basis, but if there's anything you ever want to find out, you know, please get in touch with the office, and we're more than happy to have a discussion with them about case progress, and we do that as well.
OK. And if I can go back slightly, you were saying that the waiting times is published on the websites. I'm going to be a bit rude here, and forgive me, but that's just figures. How does someone know if that's a reasonable amount of waiting time or it's not a reasonable amount of waiting time? And how, you know, because waiting for 4 months for your case to be dealt with, would that be reasonable? And are they told that's reasonable?
That's an interesting question. I'm not sure they're told that that's reasonable. What we have been doing in all of our letters, and that's including up to this date, other than the ones that we are dismissing, is apologising for the delay and explaining why there is a delay. I've already said, you know, I didn't feel that waiting for a year to have your investigation investigated in full was good enough. I don't feel that the current four-month time is good enough either. So all of our letters say, you know, we are sorry that it's taken longer than we'd like to investigate your complaint. It was due to basically a lack of investigatory capacity in our team. Yeah. We've now addressed it through recruitment. That's that standard wording in our letters. So, you know, I agree we can still do better and we plan to.
Okay. And one further question, Convener, in regards to that, are you, and I realise this is historic numbers, and I'm pleased to hear that you're still not satisfied with 4 months. How, on the whole, do you feel that it is in a better place than it was, but you're still striving to get there as quickly as possible? What would you be content with for waiting times, if that's not an awkward question to ask you?
No, and again, we've been very clear about this. We've got published key performance indicators for every stage of an investigation, and we will report to you publicly on how well we're doing against those. If it looks as though we're doing better than we thought we were or were going to, we'll make them harder. that's the reality. You know, we'll include more stretching targets, and you know, I'd welcome the views from the committee, as I did when we consulted on those on the manual and those KPIs previously. If you feel that we should be doing better, then please let us know. For what it's worth, we do actually compare pretty favourably with other administrations, because there was a benchmarking exercise done. So even as things stand, we were kind of ahead of the curve, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't be much better. There's a human cost attached to this. I mean, you said it's just numbers, and I get that, but I know that a complainer wants, you know, their complaint to be dealt with quickly. Mm-hmm. But equally, if you're a respondent, you don't want, you know, you don't want a complaint hanging over you for a long period. So we absolutely get that, you know, the entire team does, which is why we've made that firm commitment to improve. So, you know, I do want to see the times come down. In terms of how quickly we should or could be doing that, and it's amazing to me just how fast time passes, but, you know, the additional resource that we got in, they only just completed their probationary periods, you know, it's sort of autumn of last year. They've bedded in now. They're already making a difference. They will, you know, they'll continue to make more of a difference. But the stuff that we're dealing with, if you'll excuse the term, it's quite complex. And even though they've all come from investigatory backgrounds, from different organisations, it's quite niche. But they will get quicker over time.
So what I think I'm hearing from you, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, is that you're content that you're moving in the right direction, but there's still more to do.
Absolutely, yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Annie Wells, have you got any?
Nothing
to go through.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I was just going to touch briefly on the strategic objectives for 2024 to 2028. And how those were developed and what assessments been made of the key milestones around reaching them?
So they were developed in, well, obviously, extensive consultation. As a first step, I and the entire team discussed what we'd had in the prior strategic plan, and you may recall that I had to introduce that as acting commissioner because I thought the one before that wasn't fit for purpose. It didn't include values and so on and so forth. So we had a look at that and what progress we'd made against it. We publish progress annually against the strategic plan and the business plan. So we had a look at that and thought, where can we go further? And that's why an awful lot of what was included in the revised plan was about improving the service that we provide as opposed to just providing the service. We've had a number of internal audits as well, and they've made some recommendations for us. So one of them was, you know, you need to have a communication strategy, you need to be much more visible. So we've got plans in place for that. The communication strategy was published last September. So internal audit has informed our plans for the future as well. One of the other points that was made to us, so we consulted with other organisations prior, so pre-consultation, including the Standards Commission, prior to publishing for fuller consultation, we asked them what they felt we could be doing better than we were doing at the current time. So I would suggest that this particular plan is more ambitious than the one that sat before it, and that's where the objectives have come from. We've also had quite a few responses to the consultation itself, so I've been looking at those recently and thinking about, okay, what more could we be doing in this area? Quite a lot of it really is about visibility of the office, which I think potentially the office may have shied from previously. But I am committed to doing more in that area. Public confidence in the work of our office, I think, is quite important. It's not just for appointments, because clearly you want people to put themselves forward for those roles, but also in terms of public life more broadly. And this is one of the discussions I've been having with the local government committee. If conduct in public life isn't great, it does put people off. You know, they don't want to come forward for roles. They may leave roles that, you know, they otherwise would have enjoyed fulfilling. So I do think that I need to step more into that particular space.
And you mentioned local government committee. Obviously, they have a locus roundabout in relation to councillors, but there's also a desire, understand, to engage more thoroughly with other subject committees in the Parliament where relevant. So can you give us a bit of background on how that works proceeding and what interactions you've had there to help transparency?
Well, my discussions with the local government committee, a lot of it has been around how do we improve the profile of local authorities. We had a question earlier about diversity, and I think we're in the same sort of place there. My view is that governance is always improved when you have more diversity around the table. So those have been the discussions I've been having with the local government committee. I haven't put them in touch with other organisations, although I do know through discussions with, because I contributed to some of the work of the Scottish Local Authorities Remuneration Committee. This committee may be aware of the report that it brought out, but it's looked at things like whether or not people are being treated appropriately in public life, the impact of that on people's willingness to apply for roles. So there's been an interaction there, and I understand also that they've been interacting with the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee.
Okay, but not with any other subject committees in the Parliament, per se?
I think that would be a matter for the local government committee.
Okay.
I haven't sought to put them in touch. If you feel that I should, that's certainly something I'd be happy to consider.
Okay. Thanks. Stephen, are there more things you wanted to come in on?
Thank you, convener. Just on the point that was raised by Jackie Dunbar about delay, I mentioned it as well. What consideration do you make of the well-being of the people who are on the receiving end of these complaints? Because, we're operating, so I'm operating here from the background of knowing some of the stresses that the colleagues have gone through. And in fact, in one case, I don't think I'm saying anything that hasn't already been said in public by this person, but they effectively left public life because of, which I think was a disaster because that person had so much to give. How much consideration do you give to the well-being of the people that are subject to these complaints?
A huge amount. And that's no understatement. One of the first things I did when I took up the role as acting commissioner was include values on the face of our strategic plan. Those weren't just words on a page. And they apply to every member of staff, and they featured in our recruitment of new staff as well. It's not as though I didn't consult the staff, I did, but we agreed them collectively. You need to take people along with you. But, when we were recruiting new people, these were absolutely paramount. You need to share these values. They're about respect, yes, which you'd expect, and, good stewardship, but also about kindness, about empathy for people. Mm-hmm. And these things are really, really, really important. They're so important that we are now surveying, so we've rolled out that survey, we are now surveying complainers and respondents on the extent to which, and it's anonymised, so they can give us honest views, the extent to which we have adhered to our values and our dealings with them. Mm-hmm. Were the people who dealt with you kind? Were they respectful? Were they empathetic? So it's absolutely fundamental, and we're going to be publishing the results of those surveys in our annual report as well, so that you know the committee and the public can see whether or not we are upholding those values. Further than that, so our training. So, for example, if it's a case involving bullying, harassment, sexual harassment, our training. We've repeated just recently on handling cases of that nature previously, and we'll be running this again. We got Rape Crisis Scotland involved to ensure that our staff handled cases with a trauma-centred approach. Mm. But, you know, that informs really not just those cases, but all cases in which, you know, there's been an impact on the individuals involved. And further than that, I wrote to the responsible Cabinet Secretary to say, and also to the Clerk Chief Executive of the Parliament to say, we feel that there should be an independent support service in place that members, councillors, members of public bodies, also complainers, also witnesses can access. Mm-hmm. In order to obtain the sort of pastoral support that we feel that they need. So I feel I've done my part in terms mm-hmm. of, you know, running my house, but I've also highlighted, I think you have a responsibility here to provide a service so that people have the support that I feel they need.
Well, I think that's a very, very strong suggestion, and I think something that's badly needed based on the experience of colleagues, and we probably all have got colleagues who've been through these experiences and has left them feeling diminished, which is exactly the opposite of what we've been talking about for the entirety of your evidence, which is trying to create an environment in terms of public service that people want to come forward and want to give of themselves, because that's what, frankly, our country needs. So I appreciate what you said. And returning to the strategic plan and strategic objectives, I hope you won't mind if I say, I hear what you say and I accord with everything you say about prioritising complainants and complainers and all the rest of it. But I was a little perturbed, I suppose, that of the 9 specific strategic objectives that are in the plan, none of the first 3 related to any of that. The first 4... or you could say 3 at least, relate to internal things.
Sure.
That seems a bit strange to me, and I'll tell you why. Because when you did your, I think, very honest assessment of the key risks, key issues and risks that you were dealing with in your report, the number one thing that you put, and I think correctly, was loss of stakeholder confidence. Mm-hmm. But yet, in responding to those key issues and risks, in the way the plan's laid out, and I suppose I'm giving you an opportunity to say that the way it's laid out is not necessarily a prioritisation, but it comes across as if it's very inward-looking as opposed to what the risk is, which is about what's happening in terms of your stakeholders. Does that make sense, what I'm saying?
It does, and yeah. So perhaps I didn't articulate it particularly well, but that's kind of the feedback that I've had on the plan, is which, you know, that there should be more of a focus, I think, on encouraging good standards in public life. So when I publish the final version, you will find that higher,
right. Okay.
Higher
good.
Up.
Good. Okay, that's fine. Because one of the things that you've mentioned, which is really good news, is that you're surveying, almost customer survey, satisfaction survey, which I very strongly believe in. But I think also what would be very interesting is whether or not you're conducting or will conduct surveys among these stakeholders, because you talk about loss of stakeholder confidence. And I'm wondering whether or not that's something you've done and just haven't published, or maybe I haven't seen it, or is that something that's in the works?
So we certainly haven't surveyed them, and that's not something that I currently have planned. And it's certainly something I can consider, because I suppose what it does is it provides them with an opportunity to, I don't know, make anonymous commentary on the work of my office. If I'm being honest, the nature of my stakeholders is such that they're not backwards in coming forwards. And I have been engaging much more significantly with them, again, since I was acting commissioner. I'm sure they won't mind me saying, but so COSLA invited me along to their conference, and because things hadn't been going well in the office, that was a tough day for me, but I felt I had to be there in order to answer, you know, what were challenging questions, and rightly so. And I hope, I trust and hope that I gave them a measure of confidence in me. And that's a standing invitation to any public body, basically. I am more than happy to go and talk to you about any concerns that you may have. And that can be in a public forum, or equally, they can be in touch with me at any time, and quite a few of them are, to let me know what they think about how we're getting on. And again, you know, that just feeds into our improvement practices. So if, you know, if I agree that we're not doing that sufficiently well, we'll change our practices in that particular area.
So in terms of you bringing your good office to bear and, you know, your presence to bear in respect to stakeholder confidence, I think that's all good. But I do think, given the fact that it's the number one, and I reckoned, you could correct me if I'm wrong here, I reckon that these were listed in terms of importance to you as the commissioner, but number one was loss of stakeholder confidence. And I think going beyond, yes, you know, I take your point that none of us are very backward coming forward with our points of view, etc. But I think it would be terribly useful, I really do, if there was a regular, once every 2 years or something, some kind of a survey that actually brought you data sets in an organised way that you could measure and plot going forward in terms of confidence levels. Because I think that is rightly identified as a critical issue for the success of your role and of your office. And therefore, I think it's worthy of being measured. Any comment?
Yes, I think that's a good suggestion. And I always take on board good suggestions from this committee and change what I do as a consequence. So based on what you've said, I think probably the ideal way to do that is just write it onto the face of my communication strategy. There'd certainly be scope for us to set something additional up on the website so that people could submit anonymised comments on the work that we do.
I just think if it's an event as well, then you've got snapshot moments at which you can plot progress, because I think that's fundamental. And it's one of the things that if you can model from your office will be a wonderful thing to see replicated across all sorts of different public bodies and governmental organisations. And one last point, if you don't mind, and that is about the issue of, you know, in the report you talk about the, I forget the phrase now, was it super complaint? Or am I getting confused with Super Tuesday? The mega complaint that you had with hundreds of complaints. Have I correctly described it as?
Yes,
that's right. One of the things that I'd like just to hear you talk about is the level of what I would describe as vexatious or partisan, vindictive sort of complaints that are coming to you. Is that on the increase, or is that, I mean, how would you describe that trend? Because clearly you referenced the super complaints in your report. Is that a burgeoning area of focus and activity and resource that you can elsewhere?
So we've done a bit of research on this, actually. The numbers, so that was a blip, if I'm being honest, and you'll understand I can't talk about the detail. But that was a bit of a blip. But the numbers of councillor and member complaints, councillor in particular, are such that we can readily draw some conclusions about them, because there are a lot of them in comparison with the other complaints that we deal with as an office. So I did do a bit of research towards the end of last year, just to have a look at trends, because anecdotally it does feel as though there are more complaints about discourtesy and disrespect.
Yeah.
And our research demonstrated that in comparison with other complaint types, yes, you know, there has been a steady rise in those. Anecdotally, again, it's probably worth saying, so I cannot form a view on whether or not a complaint is valid based on the motivations of the complainer. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the conduct is either compatible with the code or it isn't, and that's the decision that I'm obliged to make. But there is no question in my mind that, yes, you know, there are complaints that are politically motivated, quite a lot of them. You know, it's absolutely evident mm-hmm. from what I see. And it's one of the things in the strategic plan is I actually plan to do a bit more research just to try and get behind some of this. But you'll have gathered that there were relatively few complaints in that reporting year in comparison with prior years. The numbers are way back up again.
Oh, gosh.
You know, right. By the time December came round, we were double what we'd been looking at in that year. So there may be a link between when there's an election and you get new members on board and what goes on just prior to an election. And I think on occasion the code is used in order to gain political capital. That's just the reality of the situation.
Yeah.
But again, you're right, you know, I think there's more, and other stakeholders are right, there's more that I can do, there's more that we can all collectively do to encourage better conduct in public life. And I'm going to quote Professor Adam Tompkins. I did a report about him some time ago, but he'd said, notwithstanding the fact that he wasn't in breach of the code, it's very important to play the ball and not the man.
Yeah.
And I would like to see more of that, which is, you know, it's fine. It's fine to criticise your opponent's policies.
Yeah.
Please don't be personal about it.
Yeah, it's this thing about being able to disagree agreeably.
Yes.
Which is something that is proving to be more and more of a challenge in our public life, which is in itself a disincentive for people entering public life, which is, to the, at the end of the day, is to the detriment of our country and its people. Just one last question about, would you ever be able, this is a probing question, so would you be able to break down the nature, the source and the nature of those types of complaints? Because one of the things that I think I pick up is that, particularly from colleagues that are maybe in councils, is there are more complaints being made from people that are in public office about other people that are in public office. Are you able to comment on that at all?
Yes, that you'll actually find the figures in the annual report already. Oh, yes, yes, they are. No, we disaggregate, so...
I thought I'd read it properly.
No, I'm sure you did, but most of our complaints do come from members of the public, but then, you know, you do have councillors complaining about other councillors.
In terms of public office, people in public office complaining about other people in public office?
That's, again, research. We need to have a look at that and delve into the figures in much more detail, and that's definitely on the cards, because, you know, I'd like to be able to predict, if I can, you know, what the work of our office is going to look like going forward. I think that will be helpful, and I think you'll understand from the annual report and what I've said today, I do like to be transparent, and, you know, it's important for the public to know what's going on. So, you know, the more research we do, the better informed we'll be.
That's fine. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Anybody, any other interventions, questions? Thank you very much, Commissioner. I've all enjoyed the session, and no doubt we'll see you again.
It was fascinating, and thanks again for the opportunity.
Thank you. And now move the session into private.